The Health Advocate discusses local health care issues and important topics about our health care system.
Hello, I am Matt Dinsmore, nurse practitioner and your host. Thank you for joining me for episode 2. We're doing it virtually here in my office, and I get the wonderful privilege of being able to see the top of Mount Spokane from my office here, and it's still snow on it. So hopefully that will be leaving soon as the weather warms up. I wanted to bring an episode to be able to inform consumers on how to navigate the healthcare system in a way that will make sense. Because we kind of had this pre-COVID crisis healthcare system, and now we have this mid-COVID crisis healthcare system, and we will have a post-COVID crisis healthcare system. And I want to be able to give some information on what we're finding clinically right now with how the COVID crisis is affecting the daily way or the way that you will navigate the healthcare system, how you reach providers and communicate with them. So I think some of these things will stick and some of these things will go away. All right, there are kind of three main ways that I'm seeing it currently affect your healthcare system. One is via telemedicine or how you can access your provider. The second is through referrals. And the third is how it is affecting kind of mom and pop primary care clinics. So the first one we'll discuss is telemedicine. Now, if you have attempted to reach out to your primary care provider, you will likely, what we're finding is there's decent access still, but they are prioritizing telemedicine services. So you'll see that there are many clinics attempting to add Teladoc or something along those lines where they can communicate to their patients from the safety of the patient's home and from the safety of their clinic. And then really they're allowing people, if it needs to be seen in person, to come into the clinic so long as they don't have COVID type symptoms. If they do, then there's a couple ways that they're addressing that. Either they're sending them to the urgent care to address their COVID type symptoms, or they're having what they call a dirty clinic and a clean clinic. So multi-site locations or organizations will have one site where they're saying, hey, we're seeing people who are coughing and have fever and COVID-like symptoms, we're sending them there. And then everybody else, or here are the clinics where they'll go where people aren't having those symptoms. So they're kind of, I don't know, creating a clinic that they can quarantine and control some of the risk of exposure, and then clinics that aren't. So honestly, at any time where you're seeking primary care services, if you're going to a clean clinic, it is probably like one of the safest times to go into a primary care clinic, because usually they're not like testing people to see if they have a fever before they come in or not. So if you're going to a clean clinic, it is probably one of the safest times you can go in regards to communicable diseases, right? The access can still be kind of difficult and awkward as we start to get used to telemedicine services. For clinics that are getting used to how do we utilize telemedicine, it is it's not always flowing fluidly from what I'm getting. For clinics that are used to, like our clinic has emphasized telemedicine for a while, it was not a difficult transition either for us or our patients. We were used to it. We have expanded our services and what we use telemedicine for, but that was kind of a small step for us. So I think telemedicine, though, is here to stay. And here's why I think it is a stay and why patients should get used to the idea of it being around. One is it's convenient, right? So the consumer still has some sway in what type of services are provided at a primary care clinic. Insurances have a bigger sway, honestly, but consumers do have a bit of a sway. And a lot of people are finding that telemedicine visits are very convenient. A lot of people, to get their meds refilled, don't necessarily want to take their whole day to go into a primary care clinic and risk exposure to, you know, communicable diseases, and just in order to say that, yeah, my blood pressure hasn't changed and I'm doing fine. So we are finding ways to be able to still, the second big thing why telemedicine is going to be around is a lot of care can still be delivered safely through telemedicine. So even through that blood pressure example, if somebody has a blood pressure cuff at home and we can see them, take the cuff, here's your readings, write it down. Okay, as a clinician, we can be reassured that the blood pressure is okay. And the next thing we're gonna make sure is that there's no adverse effects from the medications and that their screening labs are up to date. So we might order some labs. So yeah, that patient might go in, get blood drawn, and then we're gonna get those results later. But generally, it is still very safe. We're still gonna wanna see patients once a year to be listening to their, you know, heart and lungs and stomach and all that fun stuff. But Generally, a lot of care can be delivered safely through telemedicine without a provider actually needing to place hands on a patient. There still needs to, you know, primary care won't be gone entirely. Obviously, you still need clinics where physical assessments can be done. But I do feel that telemedicine is probably here to stay for what that's worth. What is also bolstering the support of telemedicine is that there's been recent laws that have been lifted through the CARES Act where providers aren't so bound to some of the HIPAA laws and regulations. There's been given some freedom with that in order that we can provide high access to care. And those laws have been very cumbersome when we attempt to provide care through telemedicine. There are ways around that. And there's some great softwares that we can utilize, but they've lifted those restrictions a little bit, which liability-wise makes providers feel a little more comfortable to provide care or, you know, through text messaging or emails or something along those lines. The second and probably the biggest reason and change with the CARES Act is reimbursement rates. So normally telemedicine is not a higher reimburser, right? It's really high to keep the lights on when you have a phone conversation with somebody or via video conference. When it comes to insurance companies paying you, including Medicare, they weren't paying 100% of what an office visit is, right? In order to get paid full justification and be reimbursed in full, you have to have like vital signs and a face-to-face visit, and there's certain check boxes you have to meet, right? And if you don't meet a face-to-face visit, you can't request to be reimbursed at a higher rate. So what do we do? Well, as clinicians, you say you got to come in here because we need to keep the lights on and bill at a higher rate for those who are in the fee-for-service model, right? You get paid to see people. Well, since then, Medicare has changed where I believe they're reimbursing at the same rate as an office rate for telemedicine visits. And then a lot of the commercial plans are reimbursing at 80% of the office rate of normal office rates. So not too bad, right? So now the financial incentive is there to provide convenient care for both providers and patients. And if that continues to stay after this COVID crisis, which I believe many of those things will, then I think telemedicine will be here to stay. So kind of get used to it, if you will. All right, the second thing is referrals. Referrals have been an absolute mess. And I'm not blaming specialty clinics, but we're all just trying to figure this out. And it has been quite hard from a family practice perspective and placing referrals. We've seen care be delayed and for things that are very important. And to try to be able to communicate that this cannot wait has been difficult. So, I mean, I can think of just in the last couple of weeks, there's examples of times we place referrals and we never hear back. And they never contacted the patient. And it was because they put them in some sort of pile that was like, hey, we're going to see them after the COVID crisis. They can wait. We don't know. The patient doesn't know. And they're not passing on that information. I'm assuming because they're juggling 100 other things. And so I'm trying to give them a ton of grace with that. But there's some lessons to be learned, which we'll share here in a little bit. The second thing that I heard is that we placed referrals is that they said the patient didn't get to receive a phone call. Have you received our referral? Okay. And the department says, we received it, but we don't have time to call every patient, which is not an industry standard. I don't know what's going on. I don't know if they're laying off people or something along those lines because they're having decreased visits, but their workforce may be smaller than it used to. So now we're having to tell patients like, hey, we place a referral to here. Here's the number, you call them, because we're not certain that they are calling you and they're not notifying us. Like, we're figuring out as we go how this is going. So this is changing all the rules when it comes to referrals here in Spokane, at least. Here's some tips on how, if you need a referral to see a specialist during this time, how to navigate those waters. One is to figure out who are you referring me to? Because a lot of times in the office, the provider will just say, I'm going to refer you to a GI specialist or a urologist, right? So you leave and you're like, they're sending me to someone. And so I'm waiting phone call. Well, you should ask. And within the first couple of days, who are you referring me to? What's their contact information so that you can be the squeaky wheel and go ahead and call. Now, a lot of times the referrals there, the clinic office still wants to see you, right? They might be doing telemedicine visits themselves, but if it can wait, well, at least they can tell you our providers have reviewed the referral and they believe you can wait. And here's when we anticipate being able to open up to kind of these elective visits or things that can wait, right? So at least you can get some information. You won't feel like you're in the holding pattern or wondering if you are in a holding pattern. And the person who's going to figure out whether you're in the holding pattern or where you're at in this referral process is going to be you, right? And it's going to be you because you're calling. At our organization, where we're not a fee-for-service clinic, we've actually tasked an employee to close the loop on every referral. If we place a referral, the patient doesn't get called. You call them, you ask them where they're at, and we don't let go of that referral and let it fall into deep, dark, black space, a bottomless pit of the referral network. We make sure that we know exactly what's happened to it. Either they're not accepting patients, or they call them, or yep, they're going to have to wait till June. We want to know. So we're trying to make changes here clinically to be able to be in front of that so that our patients are receiving high quality care. And I assume other primary care clinics are going to be attempting to do the same. I think this is this here to stay or this too shall pass? I think this is a this too shall pass. I think when we lift the stay-at-home orders eventually, that specialist clinics will kind of go back to business as usual. What it looks like when they're screening people who come into their clinic might be a little bit different. But I think referrals will be processed as they are, which honestly is super cumbersome. It's not a smooth process anyway, so this is not helpful. But it'll go back to the somewhat cumbersome process instead of the pull your hair out cumbersome process that it is right now. All right, and then the third thing is death to mom and pop clinics. Vinny, if you could put up the graph at this point. There's an organization called Gist Healthcare that tries to analyze current trends, and they have some interesting information that we found about what it looks like for like a five family physician or five physician independent family practice, and what their viability looks like under this model. So there's kind of this interesting trend where right now, yes, not only are elective surgeries decreasing, but primary care visits are decreasing. ER and urgent care visits are decreasing, and to the tune of 20 to 30%. And it's a substantial hit on revenue. And while they're trying to make a transition to telemedicine, you can see kind of in this graph that the telemedicine reimbursement is not enough to keep that clinic afloat at the operating expenses that they have currently, which is admittedly a lot of overhead to justify insurance billing and referrals and things along those lines. Based on the statistics they're providing, they will quickly deplete what is in their holding tank, what's the revenue they have left over. They'll quickly deplete that. And in about 4 months' time, many clinics will no longer be financially viable and would either have to shut down without any substantial help under the model that they're currently doing. All right, thanks, Vinny. You can put that down. So what we're seeing is even within the last week, a large independent family practice clinic was purchased by another large organization like a Premier, basically out of California. But I think what you're going to see is as these family medicine clinics are hurting, they're going to be bought out by larger organizations, right? Which is, I won't go into the pros and the cons of that, but what you're going to see is some of these mom and pop shops are going to be taken over by larger organizations. And I think what we're going to see and what we're already seeing in the CARES Act, what we saw in the Affordable Care Act, is this emphasis, this movement and away from fee for service, which is to tell somebody to come in, we bill for every time they come in, into what's a value-based payment or membership model. So instead of being paid per encounter, you get paid to pay high quality care. And or a membership model where you're paid a set fee based on your population, and the better, more efficient care and the healthier population is, theoretically, the less expenses you have and the less time they're utilizing resources and the more profitable you are. You see how there's some incentives now lining up under a membership model or a value-based model. And so there's kind of this movement away from fee-for-service into a value-based model. And the COVID crisis may have exponentially moved this snowball along, right? We're already seeing some movement with this. And I do think that we're going to see an increase in membership-based clinics, and value-based reimbursement models, and away from the fee-for-service model, which is killing clinics right now. It's not a viable model right now. Clinics that are value-based, membership-based, they're doing okay because they're still getting revenue. It's not about people walking through the door. It's about keeping people healthy. So theoretically, if office visits are going down 20 to 30%, well, then that's going to be still a profitable month for that clinic. The other thing to consider that, you know, I think the one part that that will pass is that, you know, when the stay at home orders get lifted and elective surgeries and, I don't know, things somewhat return to normal, we will begin to see primary care visits increase again. And I certainly hope that people will continue to get their preventative care, which we know saves a lot of money in the long run, both for people and for the healthcare system as a whole. And people live healthier, more productive lives, things along those lines, obviously. So I think while people are kind of hunkering home and trying to stay away from clinics as best they can, or urgent cares, or anywhere that there might be someone with COVID who's seeking, you know, treatment, I do think that that will begin to return to normal. But fee-for-service, urgent cares, express clinics might have a tough time staying open and maybe converted to a value-based membership model here. All right, that's about all I have for you guys today. Hope that was helpful. If you have any comments or additional questions, please leave them in the comment box below this video on Spokane Talks. Be happy to answer them. Otherwise, hope you have a great rest of your week. This is Matt Dinsmore signing out.
Thanks for watching. Ask the host a question, recommend a guest, or check out any of our other programs on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or SpokaneTalksMedia.com.